but he's willing to provide a letter of intent at that time, and we've just discussed that, and I heard you say that you would consider that as an option, as a contingent on the plan. Okay. Further, Bob, I believe you said you intend to dedicate conservation easements prohibiting development and limiting certain other activities within the wetland portions and contiguous buffer strip of properties on the north side of the access road. Maybe that's what you're thinking about, Steve. Not a pedestrian easement, but a conservation easement to prohibit further development.
That we are certainly willing to do, and it's appropriate that it be the 50-foot width that's been discussed as a buffer.
So I think we're all set.
Fine, thank you. I think there's another point that we might like to discuss, and maybe some other planning board members have some questions or comments that they might
have. I will save them for later if you'd like to bring up the next point.
Nice to hear a fresh one.
Oh, well, I was delighted to hear your report, Mr. Titus, because I have been extremely concerned about this particular access, whether it will be just a minor road or a connector road, because it does lie in a resource protection area. And again, I keep beating the old dead horse and repeating myself. A recent letter that came from Highland, dated February 10th, states again that even with the mitigating measures you are taking, Mr. Taylor, to control the flooding and the drainage, this area will flood. Shore Road will continue to flood. Now, we have an ordinance here about avoiding floodplain development, and I would like to see that adhered to, and I would like to see this access moved. Would you consider it? I can refer you to the ordinance I'm talking about. It is section 19-2-8C9. And it's a zoning ordinance, and it states that you should avoid problems associated with flood plain development and use.
Placing the road in the more northerly environment, more northerly location, will increase the flooding over what the more southerly location provides. We believe, therefore, that the more southerly location is appropriate from a stormwater management and flood control perspective.
But Mr. Taylor, if Shore Road is going to flood, then wouldn't your access road be vulnerable to that same flooding?
The height of the access road is greater than the low point on Shore Road where the overtopping takes place. Now, there is no question that it would be greater still if it were moved. But this alignment is indeed higher than the low point of Shore Road, which is in this area.
Okay.
By
So
in answer to your question, I do not believe it is appropriate to, I believe that really at this point, there is a decision that the board must make weighing the alternatives.
Mm-hmm.
We have made our proposal based on our evaluation of the alternatives, and believe that our evaluation of the alternatives is supported by the record.
But we just heard another evaluation that I'm just delighted at last to hear. But there would be less impact on the wetland if you took the entrance and put it up closer to entrance one, the 50 feet south entrance proposed by the chief of police would be the ideal spot. And be very close to what Mr. Titus has just told us.
And related.
It would be helpful to me to know if the rest of the board feels that that's an appropriate modification to the plan.
I think it would be my opinion anyway, and I would like to hear the rest of the board's views on this. It would be my opinion that what we have to weigh above everything else is safety. And that has to come, I think, above protection of the wetlands, unfortunately. Although the wetlands are dear to my heart, and resource protection areas. But it is my feeling that from all the traffic studies that were done, and from the evaluations that were given to us, that the entrance which the developer has chosen is preferable from a safety point of view. I don't think there is any question about what the wetlands impact would probably be greater there. But I think this is what the planning board has to make a judgment about.
Madam Chairman, I haven't seen anything to that effect. I haven't seen or heard that the entrance proposed by Mr. Taylor that bisects the pond is any safer than the entrance proposed by the chief of police, who thinks that is safe. Have you seen anything that says that's the safest entrance? We haven't even examined that entrance.
Well, unfortunately, I believe that letter written by the chief of police was written immediately after we had the workshop meeting where we discussed. We had at that time the northerly location proposed, and we discussed that this location was the logical alternate to that. And I believe that the chief's letter is an endorsement of the location that we have shown on this plan. I believe that the chief is mistaken in his quoting of a particular distance, because the other reasons that the chief gives are all, this location is to be preferred for the reasons that the chief gives in his letter. I have not sought clarification from the chief, however.
Well, I have that letter, and it is, you are right, it is dated August 24th, and he cites a place 50 feet south, and he has got to mean that, because your entrance, your proposed entrance, is 250 feet south. And he says, it appears to me this particular entrance would not encroach unduly on the obvious wetlands at the site. And I think that he was looking down at the pond that you are now proposing. I mean, this is really, it doesn't make any difference, but I haven't seen anything that states that the proposed access is safer.
Let's have comments from other board members before we do this.
Let's divorce safety from water flow. The more northerly entrance, as you have said, will have less impact upon the wetlands. And we're talking about the wetlands to the west of Shore Road.
Correct.
That will minimize that impact. However, it will have, for all practical purposes, a worse effect on Telmer Park.
Correct.
If we move down where you're talking now, we will impact more on the wetlands to the west of Shore Road, and we will have a more beneficial effect on Delano Farm. That's the water setup.
That's correct.
Okay. Now, the safety setup is completely another issue.
Jeff, are you concerned?
I'm sure.
On that point, can you just refresh our memories once again on the site distance on the chosen entrance? What is the site distance as it exists today with vegetation there? And if you're going to quote me site distance with vegetation removed, how far back does it have to be off the road?
Okay.
Then I've got another comment after we hear that.
Okay. You asked, what is the vegetation, what is the site distance with the vegetation currently existing there? Okay. None of the experts has answered that particular question. Okay, so I do not believe there's anything in the record that would answer that question, and I would only be guessing if I gave you a figure.
Okay.
With regard to the extent of clearing proposed to maintain the site distance, which is 425 feet, I believe, in both directions.
In both directions.
Okay. Our analysis shows that all of that can be done within the Shore Road right-of-way. However, to be sure about it, we have taken a sliver here, if you will, adjacent to Shore Road, and shown it on the latest plan as a proposed site easement.
Okay.
And that sliver would be our insurance policy in case, it's contingency. It's, how do you describe it? It's just a little bit extra to attempt to deal with the problem.
You know, Madam Chairman, I've got a question because we've addressed this point before, and unfortunately we have not provided the proper controls. And I'd like to know if we're going to be putting together some motions and we're going to be starting to put down some wording that may end up showing up on plans, what can we do to ensure that we understand whose responsibility is to clear this vegetation and place that responsibility so that it stays that way?
I understand in the past that it has been up to the town to maintain
that. That is correct. It is generally the obligation of the town to maintain site distance along Shore Road as a part of its police power. We have, in the case of Stonegate and Lot 52, which you will recall there were similar discussions about site distance, placed protective covenants effective upon Lot 52, which said, you shall suffer nothing to exist that would block the site distance, in essence. It's a little more detailed than that because it talks about the specific distances and heights that the engineering consultants evolved as the adequate approach to site distance there. And we could certainly say that it's the responsibility of the owner of Lot 1 to ensure that in the area of the proposed, if the town were unwilling to assume the responsibility, although they have always been willing to date, if the town were unwilling to assume the responsibility, and I believe that's a determination of the town councils, I'm not sure, we would be happy to place a restrictive covenant on Lot 1 that would make it the responsibility of the owner of Lot 1 to maintain that site easement as shown on the plan in an appropriate condition to allow the site distance to exist. Looking south, our site distance is virtually all the way over the pavement of Shore Road, so it doesn't appear to be a concern there.
Okay.
Any other, Madam Chairman, I have a problem with the safety at the proposed road.
because it is at the bottom of two very, very steep and what could be during the winter time and in periods of wetness, very, very slippery hills. Now, I'm concerned because these hills are blind, and anyone coming down a shore road, like let's say they're heading towards South Portland, someone who lived in this development, attempting to take a left-hand turn, has to wait for traffic coming up shore road. What if the cars start piling up behind him, and around the corner comes a car and doesn't see the cars that are I see demolition derby there. And I am vehemently opposed to this connector road that everybody is talking about, because I think that from Chimney Rock right down to the ford, Shore Road is similar to one of those luge runs I have been seeing at the Olympics. Now, what do you think about that? Do you think the contours of the road should have anything to do with safety?
I believe that the experts who examined the situation, both Jack Murphy, our consultant, and T.Y. Lynn International, Hunter Ballou Associates, took those factors into effect in their examination and find that the proposed location is an acceptable location, and and there is correspondence in the record to this effect.
Well, I have that correspondence right in front of me, and I don't see that. Mr. Murphy, in his letter of July 31st, 1987, says site distance from the proposed driveway. He refers to this as a driveway, but I question whether this access is a driveway. It's really a minor road. Will be more than adequate, and some clearing of brush either within the right-of-way or on the land. There will be no measurable adverse impact on the capacity of Shore Road due to project traffic. Capacity. It says nothing about safety, but I dug through all the Stonegate stuff and found a letter from Mr. Murphy, December 5th, 1985, concerning, remember the driveway on Shore Road and the big to-do we had about it? The police were there and the whole planning board, and we couldn't figure out whether the site distances were safe. Well, Mr. Murphy is discussing that driveway in this very lengthy letter, but I won't read it all. And he talks about the accidents on Shore Road and critical factors, etc. And he says, further analysis of the accident reports indicated, these were the accidents on Shore Road, and I guess there have been 87 since 1984, indicated that the majority of the accidents involved snowy or icy roadway conditions. There was no area with a pattern of occurrences. The majority of accidents involved single vehicles out of control hitting fixed objects. All accidents either occurred on a curve, very similar to the curves I'm talking about, or at a minor street intersection. Now, a minor street intersection is what we are creating now. And if it's a connector road, it's a feeder street intersection. So you see, Mr. Murphy has discussed, maybe a couple of years ago, safety and curves and intersections cause the accidents.
He has said that they have occurred at intersections.
Yeah, at minor intersections.
Yeah. He has said that they are.
Because I just went through all of the traffic reports.
Yeah. And he has said that, and he also said that they consisted of hitting fixed objects.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't believe that your concern about traffic piling up and becoming a hazard is on point with regard to the accident statistics.
Well, I think it is because I listened to a commission that is studying the comprehensive plan, and they said last week that over 1,000 new people will be here in Cape Elizabeth within the next decade. I don't remember the exact numbers, but it was over 1,000. Well, obviously, we're going to have increased traffic on Shore Road, and it seems to me that if you want to put your access road there, we know what is coming. You need acceleration and deceleration to really have this a safe access. And I don't know where you would put them in that particular place with the stream and the pond. But the zoning ordinance states on page 19-16 that we can ask you to provide such things, and I think we need them if you're going to have this access to them.
Your opinion is certainly your opinion, and I can't quarrel with that. I can say that neither the applicant's consultant nor the board's consultant has found need for this in the information that they have provided.
I guess I'd like to move on to another topic, and Marion, I think you bring up a very valid point. Certainly the perception is traffic analysis said of the lack of safety in that area is perceived by people who enter and exit on those roads. And he also said, however, Mr. Eaton, who did the study for TYLN, that the capacity of Shore Road is up to 10,000, which sounds horrifying to me, but that we are nowhere near that. I think perhaps we want to think, if we do a preliminary plan approval tonight, about conditioning our approval to allow IBIS Corporation, in conjunction with our town engineer, to re-examine the road entrance and exit and see what is the safest, less hazardous choice. And it seems to me that would be a very worthwhile stipulation to consider. I guess I'd like to ask the developer about the weir, and it has been commented that the access to that is very steep and that we need to think about the access and perhaps having any disturbance of the land done prior to homeowners moving in and actually getting there.
There is indicated on the plan a 50-foot wide easement to allow access to the overflow sill site. As you recall, that overflow sill, in terms of the flood study, would be required for future development of the westerly portion of the parcel. 50 feet wide is the width of an easement we use for public streets. I think it should be adequate to provide access to the overflow sill site. With regard to the timing of construction of that, it would be our intent to construct any necessary haul road along that alignment only at the time that we actually had the necessary permits to install the overflow sill.
Would you see any advantage, perhaps, for the homeowner to insert that would be done if that were put in the deed, that would be done in the second part of this development?
We can certainly, it's clearly indicated on the plan. If the board feels that as a matter of public notice it is appropriate to include such information in the Declaration of Covenants, which is where we have previously discussed, including similar cautions, we would be happy to do that.
Are there any other questions of board members?
An issue that has already been discussed, but one which continues to concern me. I have similar concerns about traffic, but I'd like to get back to the whole question of the easement for just a minute. This is an area which has historically been used by hundreds of residents of Cape Elizabeth, and based on my own use of the land and knowing people who might pass on a pretty regular basis, I would say that there are people, a large number of people from out of town who have also used it. And the proposed easement or public pathway or easement plan that is being proposed, in my opinion, doesn't provide the public with access to the kind of land that they typically view when they're there. Now, I'm not asking you to make this land forever wild for everybody who wants to use it, but in viewing the location of the footpath, I see that it parallels the road, or nearly parallels the road, would in most instances pass in the front yard of at least half of the properties that are there. And it's hard for me to imagine that those property owners would be more pleased by having people pass along their front yard than they would by having them pass 50 to 100 feet at their rear yard, and particularly in areas which are probably visible many months out of the year anyway. I'd like to have the applicant think a little more carefully and maybe with our assistance and that of the Conservation Commission to improve the level of public access in the area that is being proposed for development now. I'd also like to see some discussion about the potential for linking this development to some future development. You are the owner of the land, and even though your development plans may not be clear, you are in a better position today to work with the town of Cape Elizabeth in providing some future access than somebody who may buy the land from you in the future. And I'd like to spend a little bit more time thinking about how we might preserve not only what you're suggesting for public access, perhaps a little bit more that will give the public access to a little bit more of the area that clearly is non-buildable anyway. And I don't know whether it's appropriate to postpone decisions because of that, and that perhaps we can construct the condition that is going to allow us that opportunity and still move forward with the preliminary plan approval stage. Madam Chairman, I also have a question for you and Steve. Which may be, would certainly be helpful to me and may be helpful to the people who are watching these discussions, that is what the effect is of a preliminary plan approval by this board at this point and what remains to be done in our decision-making process after that.
Well, I was going to sort of recap at what stage we are at and what courses of action we might pursue. A preliminary plan approval, traditionally and historically, particularly under the old subdivision ordinance, which we are now under, implies that things are pretty well settled and that the planning board is quite confident with what is being proposed and that they're happy with what's being laid out. However, we can condition a preliminary plan approval so that it will allow us the flexibility before we go into final plan approval to make perhaps some alterations that we feel are important, or to take into consideration some issues which we feel are not resolved and can't be resolved until we have further time to study them.
I would suggest that perhaps we're at a point now where we should consider whether we want to do a...
And Steve, maybe you want to elaborate a little more on what the preliminary plan would be.
I think you pretty much said it all. Just in terms of the process, we've we're at the point now where we've gone past the 60-day time limit, and we've had two extensions that were mutually agreed upon between by the applicant and the planning board. So that's in essence where we are now. And I think Alice pretty much described the impact of preliminary plan approval. So I think it's important that if there are some issues that are outstanding, that those be kept open and that be stayed on the record and that the applicant know that that's the case.
So I think we have several options open to us right now, and one, we can grant preliminary plan approval, we can deny preliminary plan approval, or we can condition preliminary plan approval, perhaps giving us the ability to review the wetlands analysis that's come into us just this evening and consider what features it is recommending that might enhance the whole development. Or finally, we could ask for another extension and take more time to assess some of the material that we've received. So I guess I know that Steve has drafted a motion which incorporates several conditions, and maybe it would be helpful for him just to read that to see if this would meet your agreement.
Okay, I'll try and do that, and I did that with some advance warning of what was going to be in the IEP report, but not having read it, I read it at the same time you did, which is a little earlier this evening. Suggested motion might read as follows with some additions in terms of conditions. Be it ordered that the request of IBIS Corporation for preliminary plan approval for Dyer Pond Road, a proposed 8-lot subdivision located off Shore Road, be granted according to Section 16.2.4 of the subdivision ordinance and the facts presented, subject to the following conditions. A, that a no-build, no-alteration buffer strip of at least 50 feet around all wetlands be delineated on the final plan. And that's something that the applicant has agreed to. B, which is something from the IEP report, that the planning board and the town engineer shall review all plans to build, fill, blast, cut, or strip vegetation or place septic systems within 100 feet of the wetlands. C, that all driveways shall be situated to enter solely onto the Dyer Pond Road and shall not be permitted to enter directly onto Shore Road. D, that the access easement to the overflow sill slash weir shall be relocated on the final plan if deemed desirable by the planning board. Again, we've had some discussion about that. Another one that could be added with respect to the weir, which isn't on the suggested motion, would be that a 2-inch weir overflow sill slash weir be placed in the designated location as part of this subdivision approval, which would be the E that's on your suggested motion, that additional pedestrian easements be placed on the final plan, including an easement that would link the peninsula land area of the Phase 2 land with the Stonegate land acquired by the town. Again, that's been discussed, and that might need to be modified slightly. F, that the results of the town's independent wetlands consultants' report on wetlands impacts shall enable the planning board to require design changes to be made to the Dyer Pond Road final plan or deemed necessary by the planning board.
What would design change?
That would be that upon consider, that's a pretty major condition. That would be that upon review of the consultant's report, that if lot lines needed to be changed or the road entrance needed to be relocated, that issue wouldn't be closed this evening. That if between now and the time that the applicant came back for final plan review, that if a significant enough issue was raised by the planning board, that the planning board could in fact reopen that issue. Whereas traditionally under the old subdivision ordinance, that very seldom, if ever happened, is that was thought to be pretty much determined during the preliminary plan review phase. Sure, there's another one, yeah.
I don't think he's finished, he may be covering
that. Yeah, it's another one that I've been crafting, the minutes and hours of them. Okay, we'll see. We'll see if I've covered it or not. G would read that the language suggested by the applicant in his letter of February 3rd and by the town attorney in his letter of February 5th be placed on the final plan, inserted in the deed of each of the 8 lots and in the deed or deeds of the remainder of the site's land, which is phase 2, and in the declaration of covenants, restrictions, and easements. That would, in essence, just make sure that we incorporated between now and final plan the language that dealt with the connector road possibility. So that was assured, that was inserted and used for whatever reason somewhere down the road.
Okay.
If the town decided not to. Okay. That's okay. I'll craft some language in a couple seconds. Another one which could be offered, another condition, to deal with Marion's entrance location issue, could be, if that's a significant enough issue, another condition, which would be probably H or I or J, would be that the entrance location of Dyer Pond Road onto Shore Road shall be reexamined by the town engineer, and new entrance locations shall be considered by the applicant if deemed necessary by the planning board for safety purposes. Again, a lot of conditions, if the applicant feels that, and if the board feels they want to tackle for a number of those conditions and the applicant feels like he wants preliminary plan approval this evening, that might be it.
I've been making comments, obviously, make sure I write it.
Sure.
If we don't approve the entrance road, we're not approving the plan. So preliminary plan approval doesn't mean much of anything. We have to have a plan in order to approve it. For the sake of keeping this thing moving, if Mr. Taylor wants it on that basis, I wouldn't be interested in doing it. But I think it's up to the applicant as to whether or not he would accept that. May I comment?
Do you want to comment on that?
With regard to Mr. Orr's point, I believe the language would be acceptable to us. The only thing we ask is that the proposed town engineer's review take place in the coming month so that we might try and nail this down in the near future. Secondly, the language as proposed suggests that we put all of those words about the restrictive covenant out here in every deed. And lest we get, I think it is simpler to simply put in every deed that it's subject to the restrictive covenants and that any voluntary grantor must provide a copy of the restrictive covenants to the grantee, because there are many things fully as important to the subdivision as that particular language. And if we, at Stonegate, the restrictive covenants are some 20 pages long, and we really don't want to be creating 20-page deeds. I think Mr. Baber might speak to this just as a matter of convenience in the Registry of Deeds.
That would be certainly acceptable.
Fine.
One of them.
Yes, Mr. Orr.
I think it's in B you said that we should have approval of excavation plans. I think we should strike those two. They know not the prevailing plan. The law already contracted that, and we have a role in that.
What do you think about the placement of septic systems within the field?
I won't annoy them for that. But on the blasting, yeah. She said, to the garage.
Yes, Mrs. Duffy.
Madam Chairman, I agree with all of these except 4G, the language suggested on the road. Now, since August, when you came before us, I have been asking you for information about this elusive phase two. I find it unacceptable to assume that there is any access on that other side whatsoever until I see it laid out on the face of this grid. Is that such a terrible thing? I mean, this is a planning board. We are not in the business of assuming and looking at phantoms. What we have been discussing is Connector Road versus the cul-de-sac. It's a phantom. And I can't work and plan with phantoms. I have to see realities. So I do have a terrible problem and we vote against this. I would like to see this road laid out on the face of the earth. And I don't see how we can get involved in all of this legal terminology and connect the roads and create two cul-de-sacs. I want to know now what I am voting for and what we are creating.
I believe that we have had some language from Mr. Leahy, which puts in very explicit writing in agreement with the developer exactly what the length of the cul-de-sac would be and exactly what the terms would be on that. So I think that is spelled out.
Madam Chairman, don't you think it's assumed that there is an access when we haven't even explored one? We don't know if there are going to be wetlands, alterations, permits. Are we implying that we are going to grant them?
I do think that the motion does take into consideration the allowance for examining this issue further. If the board wishes to do so, if they don't, we can ask the developer for another extension. So I think that is what this board has to decide tonight.
Yeah, according to Article 3, Section 16-3-1, we have the authority to ask the developer to show us exactly where this access road on the other side is going to be. And it's under B, and it says the planning board may withhold approval of preliminary or final subdivision plans until location for such access is provided for by the subdivider over his own and or other abutting property. So it seems very clear that we have that authority, and that is the route I would go. We've got from A to I all sorts of conditions when we haven't gotten to the core of it. I want to know what I'm voting on. I do not want to see a full connector road placed between Mitchell and Shore at this particular Luge Run of Shore Road. And so I can't vote for this until I know.
And what we do in that case is vote the project down.
Well, that's all that
that's what we do. Because Mr. Taylor, anything he tells us about what he's going to do on that other side isn't binding.
I will, if I may, with your indulgence. The proposal in front of you is for 8 lots served by a paved road that is 1,630 feet long to the last of the pavement. A right-of-way, and this is clearly delineated on the plan. A right-of-way continues to the end of the project, both to adjacent land of the developer and to adjacent land of others. In the event that the board finds it appropriate to require through road construction at some time in the future. A vote to approve this plan is not in any way a vote to approve construction outside the boundaries of the plan. I think the issue before the board is, and I believe Mr. Leahy is fairly clear in his letter, is that if the board finds that the waiver requested for length of cul-de-sac is inappropriate for the project in front of them, they may vote the project down.
Right.
If the board finds that the waiver is appropriate, they may approve the project, and in so approving the project, they really aren't saying anything about this parcel over here other than we as developers will provide the necessary property rights for a road to be built in the event that it needs to be built sometime in the future to that point.
This isn't a public hearing, but...
One question.
Could you come up and just say where you are, please?
I'm John Boomer and live in Delano Park, and I was wondering, when is the public going to have a chance to react to the publicly financed wetlands study by Mr.
We have had a public hearing, and the board did undertake to ask for further studies before we considered preliminary plan approval. If there is a major change on the plan before final plan approval, the board may have another public hearing, at which time that would be possible. Or you may write letters or whatever. That's another way to comment. I think perhaps what we ought to do is try to gain a sense of the board as to how many of these conditions you would like to consider and whether you would like to proceed with this proposal. And I guess I'll have to go down through.
My sense is that I consider all of the issues, and I consider
Mary? I feel the same way. I'll consider them.
I would consider them if the applicant agrees to them, but then we have to at this stage of the game.
Mr. Russ?
I would like to consider all of the conditions and vote time also. I don't want the applicant to think that he's not going to be fairly heavily scrutinized between now and the final plan. However, I think there are likely to be a number of conditions, and their wording suggests that we continue to have some, at least I do, some serious concerns.
Do we want to go any further in enlarging the consideration of pedestrian easements as a part of these conditions? Further conversation with the...
I think the language additional pedestrian easements is sufficient to suggest that it may be more than what has been proposed.
Then you have heard the motion, and I guess perhaps we'd better have a reading of it again. I'm sorry, but
if you'll try it again, and I've crafted something for you, Ivan, so let's see how that works. It's at the end, though, so... be it ordered that the request of the Ibis Corporation for preliminary plan approval for Dyer Pond Road, a proposed 8-lot subdivision located off Shore Road, be granted according to Section 16.2.4 of the subdivision ordinance and the facts presented, subject to the following conditions. A, that a no-build, no-alteration buffer strip of at least 50 feet around all wetlands be delineated on the final plan. B, that the planning board and the town engineer shall review all plans to build, fill, cut, slash strip vegetation or place septic systems within 100 feet of the wetlands. C, that all driveways shall be situated to enter solely on Dyer Pond Road and shall not be permitted to enter directly onto Shore Road. D, that the access easement to the overflow sill slash weir shall be relocated on the final plan if deemed desirable by the planning board. A new E, that a 2-inch weir overflow sill slash weir be placed in a designated location as part of this subdivision approval. And F, that additional pedestrian easements be placed on the final plan, including an easement that would link the peninsula land area of the Phase 2 land with the Stonegate land that was acquired by the town. G, that the results of the town's independent wetlands consultant's report on wetlands impacts shall enable the planning board to require design changes to be made to the Dyer Pond Road final plan where deemed necessary by the planning board. H, that the language suggested by the applicant in his letter of February 3rd and by the town attorney in his letter of February 5th be placed on the final plan, inserted in, and included in the Declaration of Covenants, Restrictions, and Easements. I, that the entrance location of Dyer Pond Road onto Shore Road shall be reexamined by the town engineer in such time as to have a report ready by the next regularly scheduled planning board meeting, and new entrance location shall be considered by the applicant if deemed necessary by the planning board for safety purposes. And J, this is yours, Ivan, that the existing and future owners of lot number one shall be required to trim and otherwise maintain the existing vegetation in order to maintain the site distance of the Dyer Pond Road entrance on the Shore Road if the town council decides not to undertake such maintenance. Period.
You have heard the motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All.
Who was the first person?
The first person was Ivan. Did you?
The second.
No one.
Yeah, we still
have
it.
Sorry,
I read it. I just want to make sure. I just read it.
Do we have a motion? And a second. Now we're in order. Is there any discussion? All those in favor of a motion as read, please raise your right hand. And opposed. It is 4-1 with Mrs. Guthrie opposing. And you have your preliminary plan of approval conditional.
I hate to raise it, the issue, but I know Mr. Taylor is going to. There's also a wetlands alteration permit that's outstanding too, and either should be considered tonight for approval with conditions, denial, or a request for extension could also be entertained.
I have a schedule of questions. Are we going to hold to our 12 midnight deadline?
I think for sanity's sake and for the sake of good judgment, we perhaps should consider that. I would like to ask the board what their feeling is. This is a point of order, and so let's go out of order.
We have a couple of these and may not take them long.
That's true.
As I look down here, I look at the boathouse and I look at Freeman Mary, which
possibly we
could go on Canaco.
Possible we could make it. I think in fairness, we should let the latter applicants know, which would probably be Ponco Shopping Center and Leland P. Murray, that there's a possibility we may not be able to get to you.
Well, Murray is only a pre-application.
Sure. But I think we ought to just let you be aware of that.
Are we going to entertain Runaway Farm again? That should be a long one.
Could be. But let's get on with this consideration. And what is the board's pleasure? Would you like to ask for an extension in light of the view that we have a wetlands evaluation which was presented to us tonight and we have not? Would you be willing to extend that wetlands alteration?
Certainly.
To
the next regularly scheduled planning board
at
meeting.
At which time we will hopefully get a chance to absorb this. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Our next item of business is Runaway Farms, which is a minor subdivision application. And I know we have scheduled a break in a short while, but I don't think we're going to have time to do that.
Thank you, Bob.
Representative,
yes, ma'am.
Runaway Farms. If you would introduce yourself and explain where you're from, we'll proceed.
All right. Before you is a plan for Runaway Farm. It's a 5-lot minor subdivision in the town. My name is Lawrence Eubank. I have an agreement to purchase the approved subdivision, and I'm proud to present this plan before you tonight. The documents represent the considered judgment and technical skill of many people, and it's a privilege to be part of the effort. This proposal encompasses the subdivision of 28 acres of land lying between Spurwink Road and Fowler Road with extensive frontage along Bowery Beach Road. 4 house lots are to be created. The remaining land, the fifth lot, 19.8 acres, is to be deeded to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. Our intent has been to create a development that respects the land and the community. In our pre-application conference in November, we sought your guidance and counsel and have incorporated these into our plan. As configured, the plan calls for 3 house lots, each approximately 2.1 acres, with frontage along Bowery Beach Road, and 1 3-acre lot with frontage on Spurwink Road. All lots adhere to town requirements and have excellent soils for waste distribution. We have been fortunate to be guided and advised by land use consultants of Portland in the technical aspects of this work, and I'm pleased to have Steve Moore of that organization with me tonight to explain the plan work. Before he gives you a broad view of the environmental impact of the project, I would like to make a few observations. I believe that this is a highly responsible and laudable effort at development. We are not packing this land. 6 lots could have been created with some pushing and pulling and shaping, using the land we now wish to deed to the town. Instead, we chose to keep the land as open as possible and to ensure that it would remain this way forever. Development inherently requires change, but a sensitivity to the neighborhood and the land is essential, and we believe this plan is a credit to both. Our requests from the town are minimal. We seek a waiver of the minimum lot frontage for Lot 4, which has a 40-foot frontage along Spurwink Avenue and a 10-foot easement for Lot 5. And further request that this waiver, that you waive the 20-foot paving rule of the driveway so that the driveway is not mistaken as a parking area for cemetery or church functions down the road. Those are my brief comments. I would like to ask Steve Moore to explain the technical aspects of this plan to you, and then I would like to invite Nate Clifford of the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust to give you his feelings of the proposed transaction.
In light of the hour, I think what I'd like to do, if I can, is walk the board through the plan and touch on some of the salient points that are shown in your package, and then defer back to the board for questions after Mr. Clifford has had a chance to talk about Lot 5. As Lawrence has pointed out to you, in the development of this project, we had looked at a series of scenarios. The plan behind me indicates the total acreage of 28 acres, with Barry Beach Road being on the left, north is pointing to the top, Spurwink Avenue is here, Fowler Road is down to the south of the parcel. Similar to some of the other sites that you've seen this evening, this has two dramatic areas. There's an area of wetlands that encompasses much of what we're calling Lot 5. It's a wet area that eventually feeds down into Pollock Creek. There's a small area of uplands here, and then the uplands start to rise here, so that by the time you reach the front of Lot 5, you're moving into an upland community, and then all of Lots 4 back down to Lot 1 are upland. Unlike some of the other projects that were before you tonight, we're not looking at moving into that wetland area and developing that as part of this project. Instead, in looking at the several scenarios and development potential for looping roads through for dead-end cul-de-sacs, we had arrived at a concept of bringing forth four lots, with the fifth lot being a parcel of 19 and a quarter acres approximately, which will be deeded to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. That Lot 5, as you recall, didn't exist as such in the last pre-application meeting. It was treated as an easement over one Lot 4. Taking the advice and the guidance of the board, that's been created as a separate lot with its own access out to Spurwink Avenue via a 10-foot wide fee interest strip, not an easement as Mr. Eubank has said. What then is left is approximately 8 3/4 acre on the upland portion of the site, which has been proposed to be developed into four house lots. Excuse me for a second while I move to a more detailed plan. What's been done on those four lots is we have looked at soils, vegetative cover, site distance, access, building setbacks, building windows, and the general development capability of each lot, and arrived at what's shown on your drawing one, which is the front four lots. Lot one being an area that sits in the old stripped gravel pit. At one time, this entire area was a large field. This is all a soil formation that's a glacial outwash of coarse textured sands overlaying gravel. What was done back in the 60s was this area to the north corner, right near Mr. Layton, the original owner's property, was excavated for gravel. This existing field looked very similar to what this did back in the early 60s. Lot 1 sits at the edge of that gravel pit and really captures for a building window just the extreme northern corner of that lot behind this existing vegetative screen for its building window. Lot 2 extends down along the edge of that field, if you will. Those of you who've been by Barry Beach Road can look out into this field. There's a line of vegetation that screens the gravel pit, and we've set our building window to that side to take advantage of the vegetative buffer as our potential building site. Lot 3 is the one which is closest to Fowler Road. And again, we've restricted our building window to the front and extreme southern corner so that we take advantage of the existing large oaks which sit along Barry Beach Road, existing vegetation and proposed vegetation for buffering and screening and setting of that house. Lot 4 is a parcel which probably not most people have seen. It's really only accessible from a narrow strip coming in off Spurwink, and it sits again in a disturbed area and only becomes a naturalized or undisturbed area at this extreme corner. And again, we've taken advantage of that to place that home in that extreme upper corner. One of the things that's shown on here are the building windows. We're proposing that as a restricted building window in addition to the restrictions imposed by our driveway locations. In the careful siting that's taken place here, we've tried to increase the minimum standards on our setbacks so that our homes sit well away from the existing homes, both on Fowler and over here on Spurwink Road. The driveway locations have been selected and a site distance chart prepared showing that we have adequate site distance both north and south on Bowery Beach Road, so we can get these driveways out on there with no health or safety hazard to those individual users. The same thing on Spurwink. We have that single driveway coming out of 40-foot strip where we come onto Spurwink Avenue just approximately 500 feet down from the intersection with Bowery Beach Road. And again, that chart in there indicates that we have adequate site distance. We had done extensive soils work on the site back in the fall and then went back out in January to do our actual on-site subsurface disposal system design. The results of that are depicted on the plan, and we've shown those in the hatched areas on here, and the actual subsurface disposal plans are included in the information that we presented to you. I think one of the things that may be a bit confusing on this is you see on most of these sites, the subsurface disposal areas are located in some cases up to 50, 60, or 80 feet away from the house sites. If you look at the subsurface disposal plans, the HHE 200s, which were prepared, we really are looking at this in terms of the relative flatness of the site of having to pump much of our effluent. This is not a traditional system where it runs gravity, but rather each of these units or each of these homes, at least we know definitely on lots 1 and 4, will in all likelihood be a pumped system. In other words, a small self-contained pump in the house, which then pumps the effluent to the subsurface disposal fields. Lots 2 and 3, because there is some potential for change in elevation of the homes, may be gravity, but in all likelihood, at least lot 2 will probably be a pump system, as will lot 3. That lot 3 is the one which sits behind the existing large oaks. We've selected that driveway location and included some tree protection measures because we feel those oaks are performing a very key function for the site. They're a major amenity for the project, and we've located that driveway and included some tree protection measures, so we make sure that we maintain those on that lot 3. Also, because of lot 3's proximity to the existing homes on Fowler Road, we are introducing some vegetation shown here along both the south and what I will call the easterly border, which are proposed as 8 evergreen trees, something similar to the white pine which occur on the property line there. So we get an immediate screening up in a 10 to 12 foot height, so we have an immediate visual impact and buffering for those lots. I think those are the key points, the salient points on the project as far as what's proposed for the plan. Again, I think it's a project that we were excited about because it does some things that are a little different. It doesn't look to push and pull too much, but rather we took at heart what you had to say, brought that land forward for the land trust, and then developed this and created a series of house lots that respected both what was out there for site conditions, it respected the community, and works with the soils, site distance, and other environmental features that are evident on the property. And I think with that, I would turn it over to Mr. Clifford to talk briefly about the conveyance to the land trust.
Thank you. I'm Nat Clifford, president of the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. I'm sure it'll come as no surprise to the board that we're most enthusiastic about receiving the fee ownership of 19 acres of open space. I think also to the benefit of the citizens of the town, the trade-off of obtaining 19 acres of land to be retained as open space against, if you would, giving up 4 dwelling units is a more than equitable arrangement. Mr. Moore did not address the issue of the public access waiver, which I understand is a consideration before you. On that, the road that runs out to Spurwink has a 50-foot width owned by the developer. His proposal, as both these gentlemen mentioned, is to deed over to the land trust 10 feet of width as a strip running into lot number 5, which comprises the 19 acres. The narrow aspect, in other words, the 50-foot width, as I understand it, requires a public access waiver since you don't have the full 200 feet of frontage required by the ordinance. Now, the access waiver does require a paved section, 22 feet wide, extending back 50 feet onto the site, which would give us a piece of paving running back from Spurwink Avenue. The reason, as I understand it, is for that is to prevent a washing of gravel from a gravel roadway running off a public road. The configuration of this road running onto the site is so flat, in fact, it drops slightly as it goes away from Spurwink, so that I think if it's graded properly, the washing won't be a factor. And I agree with Mr. Eubank that putting a patch of paving off the site of Spurwink is unnecessary and might confuse people to the degree that it would appear to be sort of a parking area. It doesn't create any extremely adverse condition for the land trust, but I just think is unnecessary, again, in that the washing of gravel can be controlled by the grading of the gravel driveway going out on Spurwink. I'd be happy to answer any of the board's questions through the chair, but that essentially is our position.
Any questions? Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Any other presentation? Then I guess we'd open it up for questions.
That concludes what we had to say. Thank you for covering the public access waiver. That was in my haste to wrap up. I didn't touch on that, but I think it would be appropriate to turn it back to the board at this point. And
so you were not planning to pave at all?
The plans right now, and this has been discussed with Mr. Drynan and Eubank, is that we will pave a driveway, a 12-foot-wide driveway, into there. That's something we did discuss with Ed Drynan, and it will be a paved driveway coming in on Spurwink.
What is the grade actually coming down towards Spurwink?
The grade on Spurwink, or
yes,
the grade on our...
The grade on your 12-foot driveway going through.
This driveway is relatively flat. If you come in on this, we have artificially created somewhat of a high point back in here and then dropped in. Our grade within the site there is running at just about 3%. It's a 3% slope on the driveway between Spurwink coming up and into the site.
Any other questions about board members? We need to perhaps go over a checklist just so that we can see whether all of your material is in and whether you have a complete application, after which we should give you a dated receipt. I mean, we don't have it to give you, we'll have to mail it to you if that is. And as we go down through, we have the project name, the date of submission, and the north point is on there. The scale is all set, and I guess perhaps in the interest of time, we perhaps don't need to go all the way down through here. The planner has... Oh, sorry. We have a partial okay on 11A, the sewage facility.
If I can expand upon that just briefly. Again, there's an issue or concern about the location of some of the subsurface septic disposal sites, also a concern on part of the code enforcement officer with respect to that, but also with respect to the pumping aspect of individual systems up into the housing units and the distance between where the systems would be and housing locations would be too. So that's something I put partial because it's something that in terms of adequacy of what's being submitted, I think it's something that needs to be reviewed a little bit further and need to discuss that a little bit further with the code enforcement officer.
Specifically, what were Mr. McVane's issues? Was it on the HHE 200s, we had indicated pumps for most of them. Was it the lack of the sizing of the pump or something of that nature?
One, I think, is just the aspect of the pumps,
mm-hmm.
and in terms of maintenance, and also in terms of locations, with respect to maintenance, how you'd be able to then get back to some of these locations. I mean, they're pretty far back. Those are just some of the issues. I think there's a general uneasiness for individual septic systems, the use of pumps. Usually that's something that we see more often with common or natural cluster septic systems. So again, something that it's there, the basic information's there. I think there needs to be a little more discussion between the applicant and the town's code enforcement officer. I can't, you know, those are some of the issues I can't get them off.
Well, I think the intent was that in doing our soils work and shaping the subdivision plan, we worked pretty much around the factors that were presented to us. And the bottom line was we ended up siting homes based on what we had for building locations. And then we ended up with subsurface disposal pits, which we wanted to tie into. And the net result is that we have individual pumps in some of these homes. And it's not a pump such as you recall from the Inn by the Sea, which is a large pumping station. It's more something like a KitchenAid disposal unit underneath your sink. It's a small ejector pump, and it's fairly frequent. We've done that in Portland, and we've done that in Scarborough, an individual subdivision. So it's not an infrequent occurrence, and it's something that generally in some of these homes, they actually have two of these, one online and then one sitting down in the shop, and you, if you have a failure, you have a backup. Their value is $400 to $600. So it's a relatively small unit.
And we're starting to see those, especially in some of the multiplex projects in Cape Elizabeth. Again, I think we just need to make sure that in terms of having replacement units readily available, and you know, is one concern. Also, just the location of where the septic systems are and relationship to some of the house lots. You know, if you're talking about a distance, which I think is greater than 50 or 80 feet, actually, in the case of Lot 4.
In the case of Lot 4, that is the one that we have a considerable distance, but the balance of them
right.
fall within.
I think the major concern is with Lot 4.
Lot 4.
Yeah. So it's an issue. You've submitted some information. I think we just need to address those. The only other two areas, at least right now, that seem to be not there, I think just because where we are in the process, regarded the open space agreements in terms of what they would look like and how the land would be transferred, who would be transferred to. We've heard tonight it would be transferred to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. That has to be worked out in terms of when the conveyance would happen, which we talked about earlier, Steve, and also the actual written documentation, if it's just a sales document. That has to be reviewed by both the town manager and the town attorney for sufficiency.
Nat, is that something you can touch on as to the status of whether it's going to be a purchase sale agreement or an outright donation with an intent?
Our preliminary agreement with Mr. Drinan, who owns the land, is that following approval by the planning board of the project, he'll simply deed the 19 acres including the 10-foot access to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust with no restrictions.
I think from the town's perspective, that sounds fine. I think the town's perspective is going to want to see something in writing, an agreement which maybe is conditioned upon final approval of the plan that in essence lays it out and secures that so that there's no question later on. That's all. It sounds like the groundwork's there. We just need the evidence to show that that's the case.
I might add that...
Could you just identify yourself, please?
Pardon?
Identify yourself.
I'm sorry. I'm Lawrence Eubank. I'm developing this. I might add that we'll accept any condition that you make upon approval of the subdivision being dependent upon this agreement.
Again, it's not the issue of the transfer. I think it's just the substance. I think the board needs to make sure that what it's hearing actually transpires, and therefore you'll need something writing to make sure that occurs.
In the submission packet, there was a letter from Janice and Edward Drinan to the chair of the board. You're saying that what you're seeking is something stronger and more binding to the satisfaction of the town manager and town attorney.
For example, I'll just cite the Elizabeth Farms subdivision where it was an easement, it was a conservation easement and a visual easement, and we had the easement language there as pre-signed, in essence, as held by the town attorney, ready to go. As soon as the board gave the approval, the town attorney then would transfer it to the town, and everything was all set. I think we need something more than just an informal letter of agreement.
No problem with that.
That would come after preliminary approval.
Right, but you have to remember, in terms, we're dealing now, at least at this point, unless the board determines otherwise, we're dealing with a minor subdivision. which is kind of one-stop shopping. And that's why a lot of these things
okay.
in a major subdivision we'd expect to see in final plan,
yeah.
or in essence in final plan. Therefore, the burden on the applicant is a little bit greater to have things submitted up front. That's all. So that they can go through this
I'm living
a little bit faster. New times for everyone.
If I could get some clarification, the ordinance states that the board may or may not hold a public hearing, and I'm questioning whether the board wants to have a site walk on this site as well. And if I could get clarification on those, that would enable us to move forward and package up both our subsurface disposal questions as well as any agreement on the land transfer.
What is the board's pleasure? I would think it might be valuable to look at the site and also it would be my feeling that